loving kindness, equanimity, all these emotional qualities that give the mind the strength and the sense of well-being it needs to penetrate the nature of existence. So we can even talk about this perhaps as a paradox, in that the penetration of the Four Noble Truths requires us to understand or to fully comprehend dukkha, usually translated as suffering. But only the happy mind can comprehend suffering. If you are suffering, you cannot understand suffering. If you think I am suffering, you are a long way from comprehending the noble truth of suffering. In any environment, the sense of safety and well-being is fundamental to any true flourishing. So we can look at this in the area of sila. So one of my favorite teachings is that keeping the five precepts is mahadana, the great dana, the great gift. So too often the precepts are explained in terms of giving things up or refraining from things, and that's certainly not incorrect as such. But we also need to appreciate the positive dimension of precepts. So in many ethical systems, in many belief systems, morality is considered to be decided upon and transmitted by a supreme being. And our duty is to be obedient and not to do the things the supreme being wants us to avoid, and to try to do the things that the supreme being wants us to do. And there is a reward and punishment system used to enforce this. Now in Buddhism, we start off with a simple problem. How do we, human beings, who all have defilements of various kinds, of various degrees of severity, how can we live together in the best possible way? What do we need to flourish? And I would say that whether we're Buddhists or Christians or Muslims or atheists or Zoroastrians or animists, every one of us needs to feel safe. Fundamental need. And this is why Buddhist morality doesn't start off with some divine figure telling us how he or she wants us to live our lives. But it says, as human beings who all need to feel safe, how can we create this sense of safety in our families and communities? And the Buddhist proposal is that we make promises to ourselves and to other people, we make commitments, we undertake to refrain from certain actions and speech. So in effect, we say to all those around us, I still have anger in my heart. I still lose my temper. Sometimes I feel aggressive. I love you, but sometimes I just want to give you a big slap on around the head. I'm sorry, but it's just like this. But I promise that no matter how angry I am with you, I will never abuse you physically or verbally in any way. This is my commitment. So we can't make a commitment to have certain kinds of emotions. We don't have that power. It's not susceptible to willpower. But what is susceptible to willpower is the expression of negative emotion. And that's something that we all have to one degree or another, and which we can strengthen. So if somebody you're living with says to you that no matter how angry I am, I will never abuse you physically or verbally. How do you feel? You feel safe. If someone says to you, I still have desire for beautiful things, but I will never take anything that's not freely given to me. You don't have to worry about, you know, looking after your stuff while you go out and get more stuff, which is the usual way of life in the world. If you're in a committed relationship, but says, look, I'll be quite honest. Sometimes I feel like attraction, sexual desire for other people. But I will never act upon it. I will never speak any word because prompted by those feelings. So how do you feel? You feel safe, you feel secure. Say, I still have desire to project myself in a certain way and to conceal things about myself or to try to gain things in illicit ways, but I will never lie to you. I will never deceive you. You give the gift of safety. Now, if you say, I will give you this gift of safety, I will never abuse you physically or verbally. I won't take anything that belongs to you. I won't cheat on you. I won't betray you in any way. I won't lie to you. But, you know, I must have to say, if I drink alcohol, I may not be able to live up to, you know, in every respect. But otherwise, now where does your sense of safety go? It evaporates immediately. This is why the fifth precept is so important, to enable you to be able to give this great gift of safety to the people around you. So we need to feel safe. So you can have the most esoteric transmissions from the greatest of masters from the Himalayas. If you don't feel safe in your house, you won't be able to apply them. You can understand all the principles of Vipassana and all the Vipassana yanas, etc., etc. If you don't feel safe where you live, you won't have the emotional stability. You won't have the sense of well-being that you need to apply those teachings. This is, I would like to include in the meaning of this term, samatha. Samatha is pacifying the unwholesome emotions, strengthening, clarifying, stabilizing the positive emotions, all those positive emotions that play a causal role in allowing us to use wisdom and for giving rise to the samatha. So we can give the safety and sense of well-being through this commitment to precepts. And as we keep precepts, probably the most important perception of ourselves that we need to cultivate is of ourselves as learners. I think I've made this point before, that the Buddha referred to Arahant, the Arahant, as the Aseka Pugala, which basically means the graduate, the person who has no more need for training or education. So we can obviously infer from that that everyone, apart from the Arahant, is still in need of education and training. We are learners. I would argue that we really experience ourselves as fully human through learning. This is the power, the distinctive power of the human being compared with animals. We can learn. We can learn how to abandon the unwholesome, how to develop the wholesome, how to purify our mind from childhood until we're 80 years old, 90 years old, until the last day of your life, the last minute of your life, you can be learning the Dhamma. And learning the Dhamma means learning how to fully experience your humanity and the way things are. So when we keep precepts and we have this noble intention to give the gift of safety to all those around us, then also we are observing. So learning, so much of learning is the commitment to observation and developing the ability to observe without bias. So what happens when we keep precepts? How does that affect us? Yes, we notice that people around us feel safe. How do we feel safe? And also the sense of self-respect arises. So when we commit to precepts and we find ourselves in situations in which there is pressure and there are temptations to break the precepts, and yet we can fulfill our commitment to ourselves and others and keep those precepts, stay within those voluntarily accepted boundaries, we feel self-respect, we feel good about ourselves. This is a happiness that we should all be able to appreciate and to enjoy. So to go back to the point I made just now, we all need to be experiencing happiness in our lives. If a monk doesn't experience some happiness in his life as a monk, or a nun in the life as a nun, they won't last as monks or nuns. If you don't experience happiness on the path of Dhamma, you think happiness is somewhere way in the future sometime, you won't be able to sustain your practice consistently through thick and thin. So observing pleasure and pain, happiness and suffering, minutely. Take an example. When we, in breathing meditation, do you observe vetana? Do you observe, have you observed, when the breath comes in to the body, you can feel inside the nostrils just this sense of pleasure, natural, instinctive pleasure of taking oxygen into the body. You're extending your life for another breath. The body wants oxygen. The body enjoys the intake of oxygen. There is a pleasure in simply breathing in, if you observe it. The breath reaches a certain point, and now it has to be released. And as they're released, there's also a subtle pleasure of letting go, of releasing that pressure from the body. So in the early stages of meditation, the challenge, of course, is that the breath is not interesting. It's not absorbing. But why is it that we can watch a movie or some entertainment for a couple of hours and be totally glued, we say glued to the screen, and we're completely absorbed in it? But is that samadhi? No. It's more like a hypnotic state, because, I'm literally a hypnotic state, because there's no effort involved. And the reason why the breath has always been such a favorite object of meditation is because you cannot stay with the breath without effort. You can't just kind of relax and let the breath do it for you. The only way you can relax and let the colors and the sounds and the emotions on the screen do it for you. You can't be hypnotized by the breath. You can only be with the breath when you make an effort to be with the breath, when you make a wise and balanced effort to be with the breath. So there's a skill involved. So given that we have this instinctive need and desire for pleasure, then one of the skillful means that we can use to create a bond of interest between the mind and the meditation object, here being the breath, is by simply observing this very small, modest pleasure that comes from taking the breath into the body and allowing the breath to exit the body. Once we have this emotional bond, this ease and contentment and pleasure, simply from the breath coming in and the breath leaving the body, then mindfulness will arise much more naturally. So we can observe, like sitting, also, what kind of posture gives you that sense of ease and moves the body until you find a sense of ease. Not just leaning back and that kind of pleasure, because that kind of pleasure is not sustainable and will lead to dullness. But that pleasure which is uplifting and a sense of, the breath is entering and leaving in a very natural, unforced way. It's this vitality of the human body. It can also be an object of observation that can strengthen the interest in the meditation object. So we observe, we keep observing everything that happens. This is a Dhamma practice, particularly Dhamma life. What makes us happy? What makes us sad? And one of the interesting things is when we start looking very closely at our feelings in our daily life, we find we're kind of surprised actually. Things that are trumpeted to be so pleasurable and happy, and the things that people chase after, when we're very honest with ourselves and we go, it's okay, So there is, I think, in the deep heart of the sensual world, like the big secret, if you like, is disappointment. The sensual world of forms, it's disappointing. There's always this sense, I thought there'd be something more. But maybe you spend so much money on this thing, you don't want to admit it to yourself or to others that it's not quite what it's cracked up to be. You say, well, maybe you just need some more of it, or an upgrade. Now you compare this to the happiness of the enlightened master, the great, the one who's realized Dhamma. I don't think in the history of Buddhism, 2,500, 2,600 years, I'm not aware of a single enlightened person, monk or nun, and say, well, thought it'd be a bit more than this. All those hours, all those months, all those years of practice, this is it. Thought it'd be a bit better than this. I've never heard that. It's just, there isn't any disappointment in the happiness that comes through practice of Dhamma. So this is a challenge. This is a, or you can take it as a proposition to investigate that the happiness in the sensual world is basically kind of low grade and disappointing. And that the happiness that comes from Dhamma practice is superior to it. So it's not that as Dhamma practitioners, we're very kind of nobly and stoically giving up all this kind of great kinds of enjoyment in the world because we have this hope that one day we'll find something better. It's not like way up there in the future. Yeah, ultimately there is. But I would suggest that if you observe moment by moment Dhamma practice, there are all kinds of unexpected sources of pleasure and happiness that we maybe overlook, but that by making them conscious, we enjoy, we can feel happy on the path of practice, even though we've got so much work to do. So observe, for instance, that as you practice, there's a kind of a twofold or apparently contradictory development. One is that your mind becomes inured to, like, the petty ups and downs of life. You don't get so carried away by things. So in some ways your mind becomes tougher. People say things that maybe used to hurt you and now it just goes right through you. You just don't react in the same kind of way. There's a pleasure in that even, that, yes, there's some progress has been made. But what I would like to point to here is that we become, at the same time, we become insensitive to worldly dhammas. We become sensitive to goodness. And when we see people acting well, going against their selfish desires, doing things for others, making sacrifices, being kind, being honest, we feel we are impressed. I'm using this word deliberately. Impresses us. It's like something presses into it. Yeah. Wow, that's so beautiful. That's so lovely. Wow. And it just feels good. So seeing goodness, recognizing goodness with a mind free of that kind of dullness and that agitation of mind and a bias, but recognizing goodness as goodness when it appears around us, we feel good. We feel good to see goodness. And there's goodness all around us. If you read newspapers and you look on social media, the things that worrying and frightening and disturbing and things far outweigh the good things. But in our own world, not in the digital world, but in our own world, meaning the world of our direct experience, the people around us, I would say that the balance is much more towards the good. So it's not that I'm not suggesting we take this rosier, trying to project some kind of rosy, idealistic, new age kind of perception on the world around us. But my suggestion is that there is so much small, modest acts of goodness going around all the time, and that one of the mindful practices that we should give more time to is being mindful of goodness. Being mindful of goodness within ourselves, and mindful and more to know, rejoicing in it. Rejoicing in goodness. This is a practice for in the lay world that can transform your life. Looking for it, being sensitive to it, rejoicing in it, just quietly rejoicing. They look like, hallelujah, just observing, noticing. And so the more you see the beauty and the nobility of goodness, the more your own determination and your own persistence in practicing goodness and developing goodness, it just comes naturally. And this is the source of happiness. Now this is samatha. This is something that pacifies the defilements. It doesn't eliminate conceit and attachment to self, but it pacifies the negative defilements, allowing for the possibility of wisdom and understanding to arise. When the mind is agitated, and when the mind is confused, when the mind is dull and sad, heavy, when the mind is anxious, the mind cannot be at peace, cannot be happy, and it cannot develop wisdom. So finding ways of dealing with these negative emotions, finding the joy of giving, talked about Mahadana, giving of safety, the small acts of generosity, this is the beginning of the Buddhist path, Dana Sila Pavana, and giving and sharing whatever you can, until it becomes natural. You know, that you can find this in our Buddhist communities, so many people. This is not unusual or unexpected thing. But so many people are born, and these are not necessarily people who meditate a lot. But the moment that they get something which is of any value or any, they think, who can I share this with? It's a feeling, that a thought that just pops up in their mind automatically. This is the result of dana, barami, of developing that thought and that wish and that love of giving and sharing until it becomes what we say is second nature. So it's not the nature you're necessarily born with, but it becomes second nature because you cultivate it, just like you cultivate a flower or a plant. And that's, and when you see that in yourself, you see that in others, just as, this is so beautiful. This is so delicious. It would be such a shame if I was just doing all of this myself. Let me share some of it with my friends. Let me share it with this person and that person. These are the kinds of perceptions and thoughts that are within, under this whole umbrella of samatha. These are what give you the emotional happiness, well-being, stability, maturity of mind, which will allow the wisdom faculty to function fully. So, in going back to an earlier point, I don't want to do too much samatha meditation, I'm afraid I'll get attached. One, as I said, the fallacy is the idea that you're not already attached to pleasure and happiness. You are. Realize it. So even if you did get attached to that pleasure, it would still be a step up in where you are at the present. But apart from that, the Buddha made it very clear that the pleasure and the happiness, the bliss that arises in samadhi is not a problem. The problem is after you withdraw from that, after you come out of that state. Because if it is the state of samasamadhi, then that can only arise in the presence of mindfulness and clear comprehension. There's no samadhi, there's no samasamadhi, there's no jhana factors in the absence of mindfulness. And if there's mindfulness, how could there be attachment? No, the problem is that the mind withdraws from that state and then doesn't want to do the work of wisdom. It just wants to go back. So it's after that state, or before it, that's the problem. It's not the state of happiness itself. That's pure, because it's purified by mindfulness and equanimity. The mind has to be in a wholesome state for that kind of happiness to arise. But it's when you're satisfied, that's as far as I want to go, that's all I need. I just want to get back to that state. So you have these kind of like hungry ghost meditators. You know, the first retreat I did, wow, you know, just when the state was with bright light, it was great. And I just felt this bliss, I just felt, ah. And you know, I've never been able to get back to that state. Every retreat, I think I over, and I just, and oh, when can I? This is hungry ghost meditation. So this is attachment to a memory, to a perception. It wasn't that state, that achievement, if you like, on that first meditation retreat. That was a wonderful thing, worthy of rejoicing. But it was held in the wrong way. It was grasped in the wrong way. And something that was very wholesome led to unwholesome mental states. So this is why meditation is such a matter of skill. Because we can start off with wholesome mental states, and they can, without any moment's warning, without our realizing, the wholesome can flip over into the unwholesome. But similarly, the unwholesome can flip over into the wholesome. So there's nothing stable there until realization of stream entry. So there.